Yet talked about photons in this class. So far, we've been regarding light as a wave that exhibits the interference phenomenon, but now is an appropriate time to introduce photons. We don't have to say a lot about them, mainly just this result from special relativity. Special relativity is a theory introduced by Einstein in the year 1905 that includes a number of extremely surprising results. For instance, the fact that, let's say you're driving a car at 60 miles an hour, your car actually shrinks along the direction of its motion. And it's not an optical illusion. Actually, it's not really an optical anything because the difference is too small to observe. But the theory suggests that anything in motion actually shrinks in the direction of its motion. You also age more slowly if you're in motion. So if you get in a car and drive around for an hour and you come back home, you've aged a little bit less than whoever stayed behind at home. But that's another topic that you can read about in your book. The only result we need is this one. It's a simple equation relating the momentum and energy of a photon. And I'm talking about photons now because that makes it a little easier to conceptualize why light might have momentum. We know from classical mechanics that momentum can be calculated as mass times velocity. But you may have also heard that photons don't have any mass. Light is massless. I mean, when you stick your hand out in the sunshine, you certainly don't feel a bunch of mass hitting your hand. So if momentum is mass times velocity and light has no mass, then how is it? How in the heck can light have momentum? Well, I've seen two explanations of how light has momentum. One of them is classical. You can actually use Maxwell's equations to show that electromagnetic waves carry momentum. And it's really not that mysterious because in classical mechanics, anything which has kinetic energy, like a mass in motion, also has momentum. So if light can carry energy, it shouldn't be too surprising that light can also carry momentum. So in Einstein's relativity, this result falls out of the sky, so to speak. It comes out of the theory in a totally different way. And in that theory, the momentum, lowercase p, of a single photon, so this is not p for photon, it's p for momentum, you can calculate it just by taking the energy of the photon and dividing by the speed of light. How cool is that? Simple calculation. And later in the semester, we will look at how to calculate the energy of a photon. It's equally easy. You really just need to know the photon's frequency. So if you know the photon's frequency, in other words, the frequency of the light wave to which it belongs, then you know the photon's energy, divide by the speed of light to get the momentum. So this is a relation that's applicable in SI units. You don't want to take these pictures here too literally. Here they're showing this little wave packet. It's got sort of a wavelength, but it's also limited in space. And then they're drawing a sphere around it to suggest that, pardon me, that the energy is somehow localized. Well, I regret to inform you, you can't really visualize a photon. Not that I'm aware of. It doesn't have its existence, its essence can't be represented with a picture that you could draw. It's really something that you have to understand mathematically. And I myself only understand the basics of photons. Einstein, same thing. When Einstein published this theory and a related result in 1905, the photoelectric effect, which we'll also look at, his picture of a photon in his mind was also pretty crude compared to the picture that was detailed several decades later. Let's at least check that the units are consistent here. We know that energy is measured in joules. A joule is a Newton meter. Take a Newton meter and divide it by the units of velocity. Everything checks out. The meters cancel. The seconds come up top. Maybe you forgot that the units of momentum can be written Newton seconds. Yes, they're also kilogram meters per second because it's mass times velocity, but you can see, or you can show, that that's equivalent to Newton seconds. Let's take a brief look back at mechanics and the concept of propulsion, which is closely related to conservation of momentum.
Now, I know this is not what you typically think of as an explosion. However, it fits the physics definition of explosion, and therefore momentum is conserved. Billy, what is the initial momentum of the system? In other words, what is the momentum of the system right before the explosion?
Well, I tried to pause this before this bizarre graphic. I'll answer his question for him. When he was just standing there on the skateboard, the total momentum of the system was zero. And since he and the skateboard and the ball are isolated from the outside world, you might say that there's friction between the wheels and the ground, and that's true, but ideally, wheels involve very little static friction. Or at least in perfect rolling motion, there shouldn't be any static friction on the wheels. Same goes for kinetic friction. If the wheels are not sliding, there should not be any kinetic friction. So if there's no outside force acting on the system of skateboard plus the guy plus the ball, then the total momentum of that system should be conserved. So when he throws the ball to the left, he endows the ball with what you might call negative momentum. If we think of to the right as the positive direction, the ball acquires negative momentum. So in order to conserve the momentum of the system, he and the skateboard have to acquire a positive momentum to the right. That way, when you sum up the momentums of the ball and he and the skateboard, you still get zero. And that's the same principle behind how rockets work. Think of the rocket like that guy on the skateboard, and instead of ejecting that athletic ball to the left and giving it momentum, the rocket is ejecting fuel particles. So the fuel particles are endowed with what you might call negative momentum if it's going to the left, and the rocket must acquire an additional positive momentum to balance that out. So this equation right here says that the change in the total momentum of the system must be zero if it's isolated, and that means the sum of the changes of the individual parts. The fuel is changing or is acquiring momentum, and, or I should say it's really, there's a change in the momentum of the fuel. There's going to be a corresponding change in the momentum of the rocket, and those two quantities sum to zero. Just put one of these on the other side of the equation, and it says that the changes in momentum of the rocket and the fuel are equal and opposite. Same thing over here. In this case, the fuel is being given momentum to the right, and so this rocket, if it were free to launch, would acquire momentum to the left. So if ejecting fuel particles away from your rocket or your spacecraft and endowing them with momentum gives momentum to the spacecraft, if you can produce thrust or propulsion by ejecting fuel particles, couldn't you do the same thing by ejecting photons? So if there were no light being emitted from the back of this spacecraft here, and this, let's just put ourselves in the reference frame of the spacecraft so that it's got zero momentum since it has zero velocity. If you then turn on some kind of high-powered laser and eject photons to the left, if photons have momentum, then that's now negative momentum. In order that the total system still has zero momentum, the ship would have to acquire momentum to the right. So it seems logical that you could create thrust merely by firing lasers away from the ship. So here comes a stream of photons, and this is a different concept. So instead of having a laser or other source of light mounted on the spacecraft, how about imparting momentum to the spacecraft one photon at a time by bombarding the sail, the so-called solar sail of this spacecraft, with a stream of photons? And they don't have to come from a laser. Maybe they're coming from a faraway star, like the sun. So here comes this train of photons with their momentum, and I strung some slides together to show what might happen if these photons get absorbed by the screen here. Now, really, this would be a reflecting screen, and the photons would bounce backwards, but that was harder to pull off in the slides, so I didn't do that. Just imagine each of these photons being absorbed by the sail, and that momentum that they were carrying has to go somewhere. So since the photons vanish, the momentum carried by the photons is now taken away by the ship with its sail. It might look something like this. I should get some kind of award, right, for my animation skills. So here's an artist's rendition of a so-called solar sail, and people are actively working on such things. There's a number of reasons why these may not be practical. First of all, by the time you get really far from the sun, the light from the sun is really weak, which means it's not going to carry a whole lot of momentum. Also, how do you make a sail that's large enough to collect enough light that's also lightweight? Because the heavier the sail is, or I should say the more massive it is, the harder it is to accelerate. So for a given quantity of momentum given up by the light, you're going to get less acceleration the more massive the sail is. Here's a time lapse of one of these experimental solar sails being unfurled. And I think Bill Nye may have been involved in this project. You know, Bill Nye, the science guy with the bow tie. So I don't believe this was a NASA project. Another challenge with spacecraft propelled by solar sails, well, I should say propelled by sunlight, is that once they get up to speed, because the idea is to make these go up to something like 10% the speed of light, well, if you're going that fast with that big sail, you're going to be colliding with tiny little dust particles, grains of dust in interstellar space. And you might not think of a grain of dust as much of a threat, but when you're going 20% the speed of light, you can think of the dust grains as moving at 20% the speed of light into you. And anything can become dangerous at that speed. Well, I shouldn't say anything. I don't know about an individual atom, for instance. So the materials would have to be such that they could withstand those kinds of collisions. So I should emphasize, these are not solar panels. Those are not absorbing sunlight for the purpose of running the onboard electronics. It's purely for, I guess you could say, collecting momentum. It's really giving the incoming light something to push against. So let's develop now the short list of formulas given in your book for the so-called radiation pressure exerted by light. If light can carry momentum, it can also apply pressure, or you could say force. Here's the momentum once again of an individual photon. Here, capital E is the energy of just one of those photons. But you can imagine if a whole bunch of those photons collided with the sail and were absorbed, then there's some total quantity of momentum, delta P, which has been absorbed. So lowercase p here is momentum. Just think back to the picture with the red dots that I use to represent photons. If 100 of those photons were absorbed, you would just multiply 100 by the momentum of each photon to get the total momentum absorbed. And that would have to be the total energy absorbed by the sail divided by C. So I'm just reasoning to get this equation from this result from special relativity. We haven't seen where this comes from. You're just taking it on faith that this is a legitimate relation between the momentum and the energy of a photon. But the same result can be derived from Maxwell's equations, which is remarkable because Maxwell's equations are 19th century physics. They came from Ampere's law, Faraday's law, the idea that there's no magnetic monopoles, that the divergence of the E field comes from electric charge. Those are all classical ideas which were worked out in the 1800s before Einstein, before anybody suggested that time dilates when you're in motion, or that things shrink along the direction of their length, or what else can we say that's crazy about special relativity? Well, the idea that the speed of light is always the same, no matter what your state of motion is. Those are all modern, surprising ideas. And this formula comes from that new theory, 1905. And yet it's consistent with Maxwell's equations, which tells us that there's something special about the classical theory of electromagnetism. Well, we know this from classical mechanics. F equals ma can be rewritten in this form. The force that you apply to something is equal numerically to the rate of change of that thing's momentum. The harder you push on something, the more quickly you change its momentum. So let's calculate the force that light would apply to something by looking at the momentum imparted to that thing by light. The quantity of momentum absorbed would just be the right-hand side here. So now we've already got an expression for the force that light can apply. Isn't that cool? Light can actually push on something. And you may not have ever experienced that, or you didn't realize you were experiencing it. But according to this formula, if you walk outside in the middle of the day, the sun is actually pushing on your skin. Energy absorbed over time. By the way, did you see what I did here? I took this and divided it by delta t, and then I just stuck the 1 over delta t in the numerator. And I did that because you probably recognize this quantity. This is the rate at which you're absorbing energy, rate in time. That is called power, right? Joules per second. That's the SI unit, watt, 1 watt. So here's a source of confusion. Lowercase p right now is momentum. Lowercase p is momentum. Capital P we're using for power. It's a really unfortunate jumbling of our symbols here. Easy formula, right? Just as easy as this one. If you'd like to know how hard light is pushing on something, just look at the power that light is delivering to that thing. Like the solar sail. If you know the wattage, the rate at which the energy is being absorbed from the light into the solar sail, really it's an actual solar sail would use reflection and wouldn't be absorbing the energy per se. It would be reflecting it. But let's just imagine a point in space past which light energy is flowing. Whatever that rate of energy flow is, divide that by the speed of light, and that would be the force that the light is applying at that point. That's kind of abstract, right? Can you really apply force to nothing? It's easier to think about the electromagnetic wave impinging on something, actually making contact with the surface of something. Okay, throw that on your note card. Force is power over speed of light. Of course, which force? This is specifically the force applied by an electromagnetic wave to a material object. And in case you forgot what pressure was, because we're going to talk about that in a second, yet another use of the letter P. We've already used P for momentum, even though there's no P in momentum. We've already used P for power, and now we're also going to use P for pressure. So pressure you could think of as the concentration of force. If you concentrate the same force in a smaller surface area, we call that greater pressure. Just think of a knife. It's a lot more difficult to cut a tomato with a dull knife, right? If you have a sharp knife and a dull knife and you try to cut the same tomato, you might apply the same force with each one, but if you look under a microscope at the sharp knife, the edge is thinner. So you're applying that same force over a smaller area. The pressure applied to that point on the tomato is greater, and so you have greater cutting ability. Okay, so let's see if we can extract a formula for pressure out of the formula that we've already been looking at. Force is the time derivative of momentum, but the quantity of momentum imparted to a material object by an electromagnetic wave would be equal to the energy absorbed divided by time, I'm sorry, it's the energy absorbed divided by C, but we're looking at that rate in time. We recognize that that was power over C. Okay, what do we do now? Well, pressure is force per unit area. So let's take the force applied by the E&M wave and distribute it over that surface area. So divide by capital A. And your book is smart. They put this subscript RAD for radiation to remind you that this symbol means radiation pressure. So you want to memorize that phrase or that term, radiation pressure. The RAD helps you remember that this is not P for pressure. No, it is. I'm sorry. It's not P for momentum and it's not P for power. This is the P for radiation pressure. When you see that RAD, we're talking about radiation pressure. So if I take the right side here and divide it by area, and it looks like I skipped a step because I meant to write P over C divided by A. Oh, that is what I did. Great. Okay. So P over C is the numerator. I divided by the surface area. And now let's switch these two. We can do that, right? The C and the A are really both in the denominator. So that's pressure. No, power, right? Capital P is power. Power per unit area divided by C. So now what we're doing is we're dividing the total power by the surface area over which that power is distributed. And that's another quantity that you're familiar with. Look at the units. Power has units of watts. Area we measure in square meters in the SI system. Watts per square meter. Aha! That is what we have been calling intensity. That's the intensity of the electromagnetic wave. And we've already looked at a formula for calculating that in terms of the electric field. That's what the Poynting vector gave us. So yet another fun formula for your note card. Radiation pressure is simply related to the intensity. Brilliant. It kind of makes sense intuitively, right? I mean, the more intense the wave is, the more pressure it should be able to apply to something, if light can apply a pressure. And the speed of light, C, we'll see, makes the units all work out. You could look at the units of intensity and the units of speed, and you would get the correct units. That's really what we did here, right? Just in the reverse order. Here's the formula that we developed in the last presentation for the intensity when defined as the average value of the Poynting vector. And this formula is only applicable for sinusoidal plane waves. In general, Poynting vector is 1 over mu times E cross B. You'd have to take the cross product of the electric and magnetic fields. But for a plane wave in vacuum, E and B have a special ratio. You know, the speed of light gives their ratio. And then you can substitute E for B and you get this. So this is the appropriate formula for the average value of the Poynting vector for plane waves in vacuum. And we did the average because you may recall that the flow of power is fluttering trillions of times per second for visible light. So we just go with the average. Okay, so if you wanted, if you happened to know the strength of the electric field for a plane wave, you could easily calculate the intensity, and that would allow you to calculate the pressure exerted. All right, if you had some way of knowing, you could probably Google this. What's the strength of the electric field in sunlight, for instance? Turn that into an intensity. Actually, the intensity is what you could look up more easily, and then figure out the pressure that you feel on your skin when you're standing in the sunlight. You can't escape it. Anytime you're in the sunlight, you're under pressure. Not to mention the pressure from the atmosphere weighing down on you. Gosh, this is getting me down thinking about it. So much pressure. Okay, so if you wanted for a plane wave, you could substitute this in here. And really, we're just canceling one of the C's, or the only C here. So just get rid of the factor C, and you've got an expression for the radiation pressure. I think it would be better just to know this one. We've already done the work as far as the formulas go, but you can almost get from here to there mentally. This is P for momentum, right? This is P for pressure. How can we turn this into that? Well, what's the relation between energy and time? Did I say time? No, energy and intensity. We know intensity is the concentration of power. Power is energy per time. So if we just divided this by the time, energy per time, we would have power. Then divide again by area to get intensity. See that? Energy per time, that's power. Power per square meter is intensity. And we'd have to do the same thing to the left side. Well, momentum per unit time, that's force. The rate of transfer of momentum is force. That's the more mature way of stating Newton's second law. Beyond F equals ma, you can say force is the rate of change of momentum or rate of transfer of momentum. And then force distributed over an area, of course, is pressure. You don't have to memorize those connections, but maybe it makes it easier to see how this comes from that. Is there any practical effect of radiation pressure? You certainly don't feel it on your face when you walk outside. There's a couple things we can point to. So the orbits of small solar system bodies, like tiny asteroids, maybe Earth satellites, even man-made Earth satellites, they actually do experience perturbations. That's a fancy word for disturbances. So you might expect a tiny asteroid to orbit the sun in an elliptical orbit for all time. But the radiation pressure coming from the sun can significantly change or noticeably change that orbit. And this is not something I'm particularly knowledgeable about, but from my study, my introductory study of astronomy, I know that oftentimes in the early stages of a star's formation, like early in the life of our sun, the intensity coming out of the sun was much greater than it is today. And also at that time, there were vast quantities of dust, gas and dust, still filling the inner solar system. Most of that has been cleared out, you know, 4.5 billion years later. But there was a point in the evolution of the solar system where a lot of that gas and dust may have been migrating outwards due to radiation pressure, a slow push away from the sun due to the pressure from the sunlight. Same goes for comets. A lot of you have actually seen this, maybe through a pair of binoculars or you've seen pictures. Comets have those two tails. One of the tails is the lightweight gas that's pushed directly away from the sun by this radiation pressure. There's also the solar wind. Those are actual particles streaming outward from the sun. So the combination of the pressure from the light and collisions with these particles streaming out of the sun, we call that the solar wind, causes gases from the comet to be blown directly away from the sun. And then you've got this other tail consisting of slower moving dust particles. I mentioned that rather than relying on the sun's light, maybe some other source of electromagnetic radiation can be used to propel these spacecraft equipped with sails, solar sails. And so there's some initiative that got started a few years back called Breakthrough Starshot. I think some wealthy investors like Mark Zuckerberg have thrown in their chips with this project. And there's some controversy about whether this is actually technically viable. But here's the idea. You get this giant array of super powerful laser beams, and there's a fleet of these teensy-weensy, tiny, wafer-sized star craft. You can't even see them. I should say spacecraft. And it's like they're mounted at the center of these 4 meter by 4 meter lightweight sails. So 4 meters, that's like 14 feet, let's say 14 feet on a side, thereabouts, and a super lightweight spacecraft at the center. And that spacecraft would be equipped with a crewed camera, some other sensors. And the idea is, because they're so lightweight, you could feasibly get them up to 20% the speed of light. I say feasibly because if you tried to get something the mass of a car, like a 1,000 kilogram or 1 ton car, up to 20% the speed of light, the energy requirements would be astronomical. It's probably more energy than California uses in an entire year. That's a very surprising result from relativity. When you get regular sized objects up to significant fractions of the speed of light, you're talking insane amounts of energy. But for something this small, it wouldn't be nearly as expensive. Why would you want to get something up to 20% the speed of light? Well, if you're going 1/5 as fast as light goes, then it will only take you 5 times as long to get to any place that light can go. For instance, the nearest star system, Proxima Centauri. To go there at regular spaceship speeds would probably take several generations. You know, what are you going to do? Cryogenically freeze an astronaut? Send them out there, hope that they wake up at the right time, like 1,000 years from now, take observations, come back, yeah, everybody's gone. So since Proxima Centauri is between 4 and 5 years away, let's just call it 4 years. That's how fast, or that's how long it takes light to get there, 4 years. So something going 1/5 the speed of light would get there in 5 times as much time. It would only take 20 years for these spacecraft to get out there. So if they could get out to the planet, take some pictures, turn their transmitting antennas around, and beam those pictures back via radio waves to planet Earth, that's assuming that they could aim it well enough, because Proxima Centauri is really far away, then it would only take 4 years to get back, right? Because the radio waves are traveling at the speed of light. So let's say something like 25 years round trip. A lot of us will still be here. Maybe we could see some awesome pictures of Proxima Centauri. Now, my theory is, if there's an intelligent civilization on that planet and this fleet of foreign spacecraft arrive, the first thing that they're going to do is just shoot them all down. So there goes that billion-dollar project. But that's kind of a cynical view of extraterrestrials. Let's look at a couple numbers here. On the Wikipedia article, which we will look at in a moment, they tell us that this laser array has a combined power of 100 gigawatts. 1.21 gigawatts. Okay, not that number, but a gigawatt is a billion watts. That's 9 zeros plus these extra 2. So 10 to the 11th joules every second. Okay, so yeah, the solar sails get pushed by the light. These super lightweight craft fly all the way out to Proxima Centauri. Let's look at some more numbers. I will draw your attention to the ones that I'm going to use in a moment. They're supposed to take, the spacecraft are supposed to get up to speed in only 10 minutes. Whoa. So these laser beams will have so much power, they're going to blast those solar sails so hard that they accelerate them up to 20% the speed of light in 10 minutes. That's a heck of a joyride. If that were a roller coaster, you would not want to go on that roller coaster because you're not going to survive. That's an enormous acceleration. Here it is, 10,000 Gs. And then they tell us how much energy gets delivered to the sail. Let's see, down here, the fleet would consist of 1,000 spacecraft. Now, at first, I was under the impression that this 100 gigawatts of power coming from all of those lasers combined would be split among the 1,000 craft. But no, evidently, all of that power is focused on each spacecraft individually, one at a time. So I guess they're hanging out above Earth and they just wait their turn to get blasted. Okay, there was one other number I thought I needed on here. Yeah, down here they're telling us that the power is enormous, but it still only provides a few newtons of thrust. So we could calculate that number, right? We're talking about an electromagnetic wave and the force that it applies. We just looked at a formula for doing that. And they're also telling us that because the thrust is so low, in order to achieve an acceleration like that, you need a very low mass. Just a few grams. Okay, so just a few grams of mass for the entire spacecraft. Also, I should correct myself. They're saying you only get a few newtons of thrust from a 1 gigawatt laser. But remember, we're using the entire array, so we can expect more newtons than just a few. Before we go to the spreadsheet, I'll remind you, here's the formula that we're going to use. We may also use this one. I tinkered around with the numbers to see which ones I could confirm using the theory that we have. Here we are back in Excel. I just couldn't resist. And when I set this spreadsheet up, I didn't know exactly where I was headed. So I threw in all the numbers that we might need. I gave a cell or made a cell for the permittivity of vacuum, the speed of light. Here's a guess at the mass of the spacecraft. That's 3 grams. So I was a bum here. I didn't put units. Everything is SI unless stated otherwise. Okay, the array power. They said that the entire array of lasers could have a power as great as 100 gigawatts. That's that 10 to the 11th that I've got here. And then I put the number of spacecraft in the fleet, and I'm using capital P just like we did in the slides. Capital P is the electromagnetic power delivered to one spacecraft, one sail. And how did I get this number? Well, I'll get to that in a second. Delta T. Remember they said that these spacecraft are supposed to get up to speed in an incredibly short interval of 10 minutes. It's not like a sports car that can go from 0 to 60 in 5 seconds. We're talking about from 0 to 0.2 light speed in 10 minutes, which ends up being a way bigger acceleration. Okay, so 10 minutes is 600 seconds. The area of the sail, I went with 4 meters squared. I'll get to how I calculated the pressure in a moment. Okay, so what did I do down here? My starting point was the assumed acceleration. They told us that the acceleration would be 10,000 Gs. I put that number in first. I multiplied by 10 to convert that into SI. So here's the acceleration in meters per second per second. Well, F equals MA tells us all we have to do is multiply the acceleration by the mass up here. So I took the mass of 3 grams times the acceleration to get the force that would be applied by the laser beam. This is an electromagnetic force. Remember the Wikipedia article said that a 1 gigawatt laser can only apply a force of a few newtons? We're talking about an array of 100 gigawatt lasers or something like that. So that's where the 300 newtons comes from. Okay, now that we know the electromagnetic force, we can use one of the formulas that said force was power over light speed, I believe. Take the power delivered by the wave, divide by the speed of light, that would be the force. In this instance, we know the force. So flip that equation around. If I take the force and multiply by light speed up here, that should give me the power being delivered. So if you look at the formula here, that's what I've done. I've taken the force and multiplied by light speed to get the power delivered to the solar sail in watts, right? 9 times 10 to the 10th. Well, you could also write that as 90. Look at it this way. This is 10 to the 10th. Use one of those powers of 10 to turn the 9 into a 90. Now you've got 90 times 10 to the 9th, or in other words, 90 gigawatts. That makes sense because they told us in the Wikipedia article that the entire array would have a power upwards of 100 gigawatts. So here's 90 gigawatts being applied to just one spacecraft. Okay, so that's how we know that it's not like, you know, one laser for one spacecraft. The entire array is going to be focused on one of those spacecraft and blast them individually. The last thing I did here was, this is a kinematic equation, right? Although you don't even really need it. If you take the rate of acceleration, 10 to the 5th meters per second, and you multiply by that 10 minutes of acceleration, you get a speed of 6 times 10 to the 7th meters per second, which is 20% of light speed. See what I did there? I just divided this speed by C. So I've confirmed some of the numbers in the Wikipedia article. And most of that was just super basic kinematics. The only thing specific to this lesson would have been the formula relating electromagnetic force, or I should say the force applied by an E&M wave, and the power delivered by that wave, and the speed of light. There's one last observation I'd like to make to close out this discussion. I was pondering the formula in your book for the force applied by an electromagnetic wave to a material object, like a particle of dust in the early solar system. Force is power over C, so I just solved that for the power, P. And that reminded me of a formula from classical mechanics that you may recall. If you're pushing something, like let's say you've got your cousin on a bicycle, training wheels, and you're giving them a little push to get them going, the mechanical power that you're delivering to that bicycle can be calculated as the force that you apply times the velocity of the bicycle. So you take how fast the bicycle is already moving at that moment and multiply by the force that's presently being applied. This is how you can calculate the force, the power developed by an automobile. If you know the force of friction between the tires and the road, And you know how fast the car is moving at that moment. You just multiply those numbers together to get the mechanical power being delivered to the car. You know, I would say the mechanical power is going from, well, not it's not going from the ground into the car. Ultimately, it's the friction force between the ground and the tires which provides the acceleration, but that friction force only exists because the engine is a grinding the wheels into the road or torquing them into the road. Anyway, it's important to understand that V is the speed of the thing that you're pushing on. So how do we get that formula? We just recognize that power is the rate at which you're doing work on the object, right? Work and energy are equivalent. So you take the amount of the amount of work that you do on the thing that you're pushing, and you divide it by the amount of time it took to do that, so joules per second. But the infinitesimal amount of work that you do when you push something through a tiny displacement dx is just f dx. So this is a simple derivation from classical mechanics. And then we recognize that dx, that's the tiny displacement in position over the tiny time interval, that's what we call speed. Distance traveled over the time interval. So that's how we get to this formula. So there appears to be a discrepancy here. Which is it, FV or FZ? Go back now to an electromagnetic wave pushing on something like a tiny dust particle that's being accelerated away from the sun. This is what classical mechanics tells us. It doesn't say anything about the nature of the force, whether it's the ground pushing on a sports car, or you pushing on your little cousin on the bicycle, or something pushing on a dust particle. And yet, according to this formula, if that push is coming from a light wave, you're supposed to use the speed of light and not the speed of the grain of dust. That's confusing because most of the time, dust grains in the solar system, at least, are not going anywhere near the speed of light. Maybe the speed here is 1/100th the speed of light. So these two formulas for the power delivered by the electromagnetic wave to the grain of dust, did I say sand earlier? Grain of dust. Those two formulas will yield wildly different answers depending on which one you use, because the speed of light is way greater, probably, than the speed of the dust particle. So which is appropriate? Well, if the thing doing the pushing is an electromagnetic wave, this would be the appropriate formula. And I had to give some thought to why there's a discrepancy there. I had never thought of this before, and the best I can come up with is this. We got this formula, remember, from special relativity. We looked at the momentum carried by an individual photon. And as far as I know, that equation, that, or that formula, P equals E over C, relating the momentum and energy of a single photon, that formula is relativistically correct, meaning it doesn't matter how fast wait a minute, I almost said the particle, but we're talking about photons here, not massive particles. It's a relativistically correct formula. And while many of the results of special relativity are surprising, one of the most surprising is that F equals ma breaks down as you approach the speed of light. So I'll keep this brief here, but imagine when you think about F equals ma, and I'm sorry I don't have a slide here. If you apply a finite force, you know, a force with a given number to a super tiny dust particle, you might end up with a large acceleration. And it could also be an electron in a cathode ray tube. The electric field pushes on an electron hard enough to produce an acceleration that's way bigger than g. You know, it could be 10,000 meters per second per second, or 1,000,000 meters per second squared. If you keep accelerating at that rate for even just a few seconds, then according to regular old kinematics, you would excuse me, you would exceed the speed of light very quickly. So if you apply F equals ma literally and basic kinematics, you can show that the electron inside a cathode ray tube, for instance, should exceed the speed of light within just a fraction of a second. And we know that nothing with mass is supposed to go faster than light. So maybe you're suspecting here that F equals ma is not the final word on the dynamics of small things that approach the speed of light. And that's true. So all of that to say that this result really depends on F equals MA. The whole concept of work, actually, that came from the work kinetic energy theorem. The integral of force over distance is the change in kinetic energy, 1/2 mv squared. That came from Newton's second law. For those of you who didn't take mechanics with me, I emphasize that a lot, that the work kinetic energy theorem is a direct rewriting of F equals ma. So the reason for the discrepancy between these two formulas is that this equation is really only an approximation. It's not even correct as things approach the speed of light. This is not a relativistically correct equation, but I'm guessing that this one is. So if you're talking about a force applied by an electromagnetic wave, this is the formula that you would use. Gesundheit. There's a terror of knowing what this world is about. Watching some good friends scream, get me out. Tomorrow, get you higher. There's a lot of people on the street.